Thank you very much, Professor Pop, for this very interesting story on a Romanian nation, a Romanian people. And usually when we present the nation brand, what is the most important thing is to develop this brand, and the second, to communicate this brand. That's why what Professor Pop succeeded to tell you the story, the cultural story of Romanian people. But when we are talking about nation branding, we have in mind today the real world of interconnectedness and of globalization. And usually when we use this term globalization, we have in our mind the economic or the market issues. But in my own opinion, and I hope and others, today terms, today meaning of globalization includes not only economic market issues, but in the same time, the cultural issues and even political. We cannot divide today meaning of globalization from cultural and political issues. I would like to tell you that when the large majority of audience here was born, there was a huge fear that globalization means standardization, that globalization is a lot of not Romanian Dracula, but global Dracula, that somebody can stop, you know, diversity and differences. What we are seeing today is that globalization helps and encourages both diversity and differences. Like in the case of Dracula, it was a story 20 years ago about what is happening if globalization is coming, you know. But what is quite clear from our point of view, and personally I agree with the held definition, globalization means widening, deepening, and speeding up global interconnectedness. You like it or you don't like it, it happened. And we have to take it in consideration. What is, from the point of view of understanding and management process, very important is to realize how the flows of information, of debates, of communication, of transactions are proceeding, are working. And if we'll define the space of flows, we'll be able to find, you know, this network society, because Professor Pop mentioned here the meaning of nation and that the nation will survive. And what is quite clear now, that the new meaning of nation includes and this network nation or networking society. I will repeat again that the current space of flows not include only economic, financial transactions, but ethnic, technological, and economical, finance, media, and of course, ideas. And from the point of view of current flows of interconnectivity, I have to tell you that from management point of view, from management perspective, it's quite clear that the globalization operates through regional and national. And in this way, I fully agree with Professor Pop. Yes, nation survive and will survive in near future, despite this process of globalization. And a lot of characteristics which Professor Pope defined regarding the central and southeastern part of Europe, you can find in Western Hemisphere, in Africa, in Asia, and in many others. That's why, and I'm talking this time as a former negotiator, if you want to be a good international negotiator, you have to be able at the same time to manage both national and regional values, and of course to be able to understand and to manage the global and international flows. I would like to tell you a few positive effects, consequences of globalization. And to be sure that globalization doesn't mean only, you know, catastrophic consequences, but at the same time, positive effects. First of all, and the large majority of audience here is practicing every day, first of all, the globalization helps us to overcome the barriers of geography and of time. I'm sure that you are communicating, you know, every day with continents, with your friends, with your partners, you know, everywhere in the world. What is very, very important even for our discussion on creativity industry. This flow of flows of information and this international global communications facilitate a lot this sharing knowledge. Usually, you meet a lot of companies which said and. Consultancy companies and corporations which said, okay, I will share with you from our know-how, and if you like, blah, blah. We have to take in consideration that because of this new approach of globalization, we are able to share this knowledge, which is truly very important for innovative and for creative society. It's very important for skills transfer. During our simulation on international negotiation, how cultural values affect international negotiation, we have practiced this transfer of skills from, let's say, American culture to European culture, to us Asian culture, and so on, so on. And this is truly very important for a practitioner in the international affairs and for international negotiators. It's absolutely clear, and you are here, a community, a cosmopolitan community, and this cosmopolitan community is so important for developing the innovation and creativity. Just try to analyze your own behavior when you came first here in Berlin at ICD and when you leave the institute. Of course, we have our area of international, our domain of international relations said that there are two main topics of interactions. Cooperation and conflict. You have to decide. You like conflict? Okay, when you get married, you have to find a perfect man, you know, or woman. If you like cooperation, you have to negotiate how Americans are saying. You have to negotiate every day, not only, you know, every week or every month, every day. The globalization and this flow of information and of communication truly help a lot, and cooperation. And of course, I don't know how many of this audience will say, oh, I'll be able to live without talking or communicating every day with my friends from America or from Asia or from Europe. From your point of view, the life today is interconnectedness way of life. That's why interacting, learning every day, talking every day together, we are able to identify and to clarify both our interests and our awareness regarding the common problems. That's why we are saying that we are living today and we are going towards a more interconnected world. I'm sure that you are familiar with the term nation branding, and Simon Anhold, almost two decades ago, was the guy which defined for first time the term nation branding. And he took in consideration the industrial and the market branding, and he said, why nations, why countries are not able to brand their identity, their reputation, and their image? Of course, he said that it's not fair, it's not clear, it's not fair brand only products, but in order to promote a country and for promoting some products, sometimes it's necessary to brand the country or the nation. A recent study defines nation branding as an intersection of national identity and globalization. What that means? That means that we cannot understand, we cannot operate, we cannot manage both politically and economically some areas without putting together identity, national identity, reputation, and of course, these global flows or this globalization process. What's very important today for both countries, companies, and individuals? What is very important? What is the domain from the point of view of international relations again, which raised almost half century in middle of 16th, last century? You know, communication, international communication. What does mean globalization? Interactivity, interconnectedness. What does mean? Everyday communication. If we want to communicate something about Romania, and we'll say, Romania, your first image perhaps will be Dracula. Look, I am a relative of Dracula because I was born in Transylvania. But Professor Pop said, Dracula is not originated from Transylvania. And I'll say, look my tooth. I have the proof that I'm a relative of Dracula. He knows very well. we have to communicate. We have to communicate our identity. We have to communicate our characteristics. And we have to communicate not only wishes, not only desires, not only programs. We have to support these ideas, these wishes, with our reason to act at the global level. That's why I said in total accord with Professor Pope, yes, nation will survive, national identity will be in near future a very important tool both for nation itself and for the global community, for understanding and in the same time for managing relationship or interactions. Okay, I would like to, is somebody here from South Korea? Yeah, no. I took the case of South Korea because in the last, how long time is from 2011, 2011, 4 or 5 years, yeah? Korean government began a huge program of international communication based on cultural diplomacy and based on redefining a nation brand. When you said nation, South Korea, what you have in your mind? Not Dracula. Samsung, yes? And Daewoo, and I don't know, Hyundai. I'm not very familiar with Hyundai, but little bit with Samsung, yeah? But the both leaders of South Korea, a couple of years ago, were not very happy with the nation brand, the brand of their nation, of their country, which is one of the very developed economically country. They said, okay, because it is an economic developed country, but if somebody say, ah, he's from South Korea, ah, Samsung, he identify the nation with a product. And of course, perhaps South Koreans themselves were not very happy with such nation branding. That's why a couple of years ago, the government started a new program to redefine the nation branding of South Korea. And very impressive, they put in this program 1% of the national budget. 1% of national budget. And not only government invested in redefining nation branding process, but even these companies, Samsung, Daewoo, and Hyundai, began to invest in some cultural events and in some cultural products. What they were saying, okay, we have to invest not only in economy, but in the same time in culture and in politics. In culture, meaning developing new, let's say, cultural creative industries, and in the same time developing new programs within the university, cultural programs, and a lot of national agencies having the job of promoting cultural values of South Korea. And today, after 4 or 5 years, we have to say that the nation branding of national brand of South Korea is different. Is different one. Is the perception of South Korea is not only this industrial product, but the culture. If you are a fan of K-pop, you can see there a lot of stars, world stars, coming from South Korea. But they were promoted in a, you know, very good places. Okay, it is what is very important for South Korean brand. South Korean redefinition of nation brand was very aggressive in including cultural values, but not involving policies. Political values. And the perception was that South Korea, South Koreans are not offensive. They are, how we are saying in negotiation, win-win partners of negotiation. And it was good, both for finance and the economy of South Korea, and for their perception, on today's perception. And they succeeded with this perception to convince international organizations, regional organizations, and even states, strong states, very, very powerful states, to work with South Korea government and with South Korea as a country for some regional and international programs, both social and political programs. In this way, practically, South Korea succeeded to influence international and regional communities in the way how they didn't succeed being the very powerful and very, very strong economic country. I encourage you, I advise you to take this case because it's truly very, very important. I wanted and to emphasize how important it is to add to the market values and the cultural values. And in this case, how important it is to be able to practice even cultural diplomacy. Yesterday, I think Mark did mention several cases of countries which are practicing very, very aggressive cultural diplomacy. I will say that China, since 2010, Turkey, since 2012, they are investing a lot in cultural diplomacy. And not, as I mentioned, the case of South Korea, not governments only, but companies, NGOs, and of course, sometimes individuals, which, what kind of individuals? Which are in the first, 10 places of this ranking of billionaires. it's a joke, but somebody this type are able to invest. Okay, I will tell you that developing the nation branding means, as I mentioned here, and I don't want to repeat, a lot of activities which would be developed both by government and non-governmental organization, both at the local level, regional level, and international level. Marketing and promoting this kind of activities is very important. And how you are promoting, how you are marketing, through different communication channels. That's why, since 1965, in our area of international relations, we were developing a sub-domain of so-called international or global communication. This area was practically developed by marketing and by companies, and they develop what I did mention yesterday, so-called corporate cultural diplomacy. And for this reason today, we are facing so different approaches of both nation branding and cultural diplomacy. Of course, I don't want to keep you busy with my opinion, but it's very important to operate with issues of identity, how Professor Pope proceeded. When he presented the symbols of the countries, he presented, if you like, first stage of identity. Who defines this identity? Somebody from abroad? No, nation, country itself. Identity means how you define yourself. The image is how defines somebody from abroad. And that's why we are working with image as a very important tool, both of communication and of marketing or promoting some countries or products. But several times we are facing a lot of stereotypes. I remember when I was negotiating MFN status for Romania in 1992, 1994, it's very important, stereotypes, don't ask me because I don't remember, because I hate these stereotypes, about Romania, which were in the same time image and nation branding, you know? And it was truly so difficult for a chief negotiator to negotiate with partners which look at you through these stereotypes. These stereotypes play a very important role in negotiation and in practicing international diplomacy. Of course, nation branding means, according with Simon, as I told you, Arnold, reputation. Not only companies are interested on keeping their reputation, high reputation, the countries too. Why? Because today, practically, in everyday foreign policy management or international policy management, we are facing, you know, a lot of actors, and first question of one of the partners when interact with somebody is about reputation of this partner. That's why there are so many tools, methods of developing reputation, promoting reputation, and breaking reputation sometimes. And you can read even in political life how politicians are, you know, struggling to promote a very nice reputation as a prince of angels, and how others are say these are sons of Dracula or something like that. I will close with a recent analysis of promoting nation branding. Nation branding, in order to be promoted, is not the job only of the government. According with a French author, nation branding requires as the implication of all stakeholders, both governmental and non-governmental stakeholders, individuals, citizens, a population of one country, in my own opinion, is a very convincing actor in promoting brand of a country. And of course, it's very difficult now to say what is a real image or brand and what is propaganda. Why? Because of so different tools and ways of communication. From the point of view of nation branding, it's so important to have similar perception of the realities, and from the point of view of politics, and from the point of view of citizens. And in this way, practically, the nation branding will work absolutely clear. Okay, I'm closing now my presentation, saying that nation branding is not only a tool of developing or breaking reputation of one country. From the point of view of the global market, from the point of view of international communication, is truly a very important tool of managing international relations, managing international negotiation, and even a regional organization and international organization. Second, nation brands are rooted, and as I mentioned, in national culture. And why we define, or why we present our nation branding, is to prove similarities or differences according with the interest of the country or the interest the promoter has. Secondly, or thirdly, not only countries, but today international or regional organizations like European Union, like Southeastern Asia organization, like Mercosur in Latin America, and so on, regional organization are very, very presented in this global affairs of promoting or developing regional or national branding or city brand. It's quite clear now that we cannot live, you know, without global communication and without global perception. And if we want several times, if we want to understand a local decision or a national decision, we have to clarify and global interconnectedness of these local interactions or regional interaction. In this international communication process developed in the framework of or in the context of global interconnectedness, please believe me that nation branding doesn't mean only propaganda, means first of all very important, a very valuable tool of understanding and in the same time of improving, developing international community and regional communities. Thank you very much.